must encounter another of the Godhead. He is called the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Somebody said the Holy Spirit. Said the Holy Spirit. You know, why do you read the Bible?
How about a baby?
You will hear there are times when God discusses himself as a plural God. He will say, let us create man in our image and after our likeness. In another day, he will say, men are one, whatever they plan to do shall prosper. Let us go down and confuse that language. Why is God addressing himself as a plural God? It is because He manifests himself as the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Bible says there are three that bear witness in heaven. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. We all understand that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld him as the only begotten of the Father. We saw glory, grace manifested through him. So God, even though he is one, he manifests in three persons. When Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, the three of them were at play at the same time. The Bible says, and Jesus came to John. He said, baptize me. And John was trembling. He said, I'm not worthy to untie even your shoelaces, because you are my God. Jesus said to him, let us perform this deed so that we fulfill all righteousness. So Jesus is there. Your Bible says, when John pushed Jesus under the water, and when Jesus came out of the water, the heavens ruptured, and there came a spirit limping in the shape of a dove. He is not the dove. He came in the form of a dove and landed upon Jesus. That is the Holy Spirit. And a voice spoke, this is my Son, in whom I am well pleased. That was the voice of the Father. It was the Trinity at work all at the same time. The Son was there. The Holy Ghost was there, and the Father was there. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Now let me come to the text, because I'm in a hurry here to deal with the Holy Ghost baptism. In this Acts chapter 19, there's a very interesting happening here. The Bible says another of the preachers in the name of Apollos had gone to Corinth. And Paul went down to Ephesus. When he got there, he found believers. Someone said he found believers. He was so excited that there are Because this question is very important. And that's why we are asking the same question today. He says to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed on Jesus as the Christ? Ask your neighbor, did you receive the Holy Ghost when you believed in Jesus? It is a very critical question that every believer must answer. Did you receive the Holy Spirit? Because he understood that they were disciples of Jesus. But he wanted to understand, after believing in Jesus, did you receive the Holy Ghost? It is imperative to every believer, after believing in Jesus and receiving eternal life, for them to live a victorious life on the surface of the earth, to answer this question. But they answered him. They said, no, we have not yet received the Holy Spirit. Not even have we heard about him. Paul was not happy at all that there are disciples in church, in the church of Ephesus, who are not filled with the Holy Ghost, who did not know the Holy Ghost. Listen to me, church. Everyone that believes in Jesus, after they believe in Jesus, they must answer this question and say, yes, we have received him and we know him. If your answer to this question is no, it is very important that today, Tabakaya, we introduce you to this Holy Ghost. Today, after today, you must answer this question with a yeah and amen. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
I say hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
I want to promise you something. If you have not received him, today marks the end of such a testimony. Today you are going to receive him. Today you are going to be filled. And you will know him. You will encounter him. And your life will never be the same. Say yes.
What a yes.
In this service,
what do you mean?
I want to introduce you to the Holy Ghost.
Not
only for you to know about him, you are going to know him. If you are not filled with the Holy Ghost, this is your service. Tell a neighbor you are at the right place, at the right time, listening to the right way from the right preacher who serves the right God. Today, we will encounter the Holy Ghost, the third person of the Trinity. So the Bible says in verse number 3, and he asked them the other question, into what baptism were you baptized? They said, into John's baptism. They were baptized under the Old Testament. They were baptized in water, but under the Old Testament. Their baptism was religious. Religious. See, you can be baptized religiously.
When
you are just what did you do really expect? Watch, verse 4. And Paul said, John baptized with the baptism of repentance. And in his message, he was talking about the one who should come. Talking about Jesus. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hey, I love this. Let's look at the next number, then number 5. On hearing this, they were baptized again. This time, in the name of the Lord Jesus. You know what it means? They were once baptized, but it was not into Jesus. They were baptized into the baptism of repentance. Let me simplify it for you. Baptism in Jesus means that when you were baptized, you were baptized into the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, and the power that comes in that. It was not a religious activity. In him you died. With him you were buried. With him you rose again from the dead. This is baptism into the Lord Jesus. That's the baptism that we baptize the group we are giving certificate today. Baptism into Jesus. The Christ of Nazareth. That he came, he died, was buried, and he rose again. We die with him. We are buried with him. And we rise together with him. It's not a religion. It's not a tradition. It's not a common practice. It is something we do out of revelation, with the understanding that the old man is dead. Behold, the new has come. Because the life that I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God. Oh, excuse me, today I feel power like I've never felt it before. In the name of Jesus Christ. Listen. He baptized them again. He baptized them into understanding. They now had a revelation of who Jesus is. And they entered. Some of you must be baptized again. You cannot explain your baptism. You need to know that you are now in Christ. That in him you live. In him you move. In him you have your being. It's not just an act. Of swimming. It's a supernatural act. I'm going to preach quickly. Going somewhere to pray. I'm coming after the people that answered no to my question. Have you received the Holy Spirit? Look, verse 6. As Paul, after he baptized them, and he laid his hands upon them, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit came on them. And they spoke in foreign unknown tongues, languages and prophecies. After he baptized them into salvation, into the death, burial, The Bible says something began to come upon them. It's called the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says, as evidence that he came, they began to speak with new tongues, foreign unknown tongues, and prophesy. To prophesy means they began to say mysteries of the kingdom of God. They were filled with the one they never knew. When they encountered Paul and he preached to them that they should be baptized into the Christ of Nazareth. His death, burial, and resurrection. When they got to that dimension and came out of the water, he laid hands upon them. And they were filled with the Holy Ghost. If you have never seen before, you are in the right place.
Listen,
are you listening to me? Let me just tell you something that you need to know. Some of you are going to be filled when I'm preaching. Some will be filled when I lay hands upon you. I will confirm it to you in scripture. But I just want you to be prepared. Something is going to come up. And it will be in the power of God. Somebody say, I hear. Say, I hear.
I hear.
Now, I want you to understand something. A Christian life without the Holy Spirit is a weak life. You are born again. Yes. When you die, you go to heaven. But you cannot live a Christian life.
Now, again,
void of the Holy Ghost. No! For you to live a victorious life in this world, you need the power of the Holy Ghost. Acts chapter 1, verse number 4. It's very important for a believer to be filled with the Holy Ghost. When you don't have the Holy Ghost, you live your life from the arm of the flesh. You struggle to pray. You struggle to read your Bible. You struggle to love. You struggle to have peace. You struggle to have joy. Yes, you are saved, but you are void of power. And while being in their company, this is Jesus after resurrection. He is with his disciples. And while being in their company, eating with them, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the Father had promised, of which he said, you have heard me speak. Let's go. For John, this is that baptism. For John,
Johann
baptized you with water. But not many days from now, you shall be baptized with, placed in, introduced into the Holy Ghost. That's number six. So when they were assembled, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will re-establish the kingdom and restore it to Israel? They were not understanding what he was talking about. They believed that Jesus went to sit on the seat of the throne of Pharaoh or Pilate or such type of people. To rule
Israel.
So he brushed them off, verse 7. He said to them, it is not for you to become acquainted with and know what time brings the things and events of time and that definite period. It's right to confuse them so that they leave such a topic.
Or
fixed years and seasons. Their critical niche in time, which the Father has appointed, fixed and reserved by his own choice and authority and personal power. Jesus is trying to tell them, look, this thing that I've come to rule here, you are lost. Let's even not talk about it.
Jesus only can go back and say, "Tawala, can you look at me and ultimate? And let's go
back to the topic I'm trying to discuss." Are you well?
Let's go back and get naked and kayo.
Verse 8. But you shall be. See, because sometimes even the enemy.
Now when we live, Mama.
When we discuss important subjects,
Harry, why did
he wants to whisper a